was. I used a lot of people for support and I started recovering. I was always being told by my brother that my friends said hi, and the fact that I couldn't really eat it made it really hard. I stayed in touch with people constantly and things at home got better, trust gradually developed. After going through the rehab, I had a lot of sweet friends. I had a girlfriend who I needed with, so much had been going really good. I had a diploma, a brand new car, a driver's license and a good relationship with my parents. My girlfriend had seen a therapist who told her we should get involved in something together, like starting an NA meeting in our area. This NA meeting was over an hour away, and the room only 2 months of that. After we started the meeting, she got high and moved out. My best friend had been getting high for a while and they started going out together, and that really lifted me up inside. I had a dog who I cried to every night and he couldn't understand and ran away. My girlfriend moved out of the apartment and I felt like nothing. The two friends I had left were still friends of hers and spent a lot of time with her. I was lonely, isolated, depressed, and I needed help. Since I had started this NA meeting, I continued to go in the meeting group. Here I was with 2 years, crying in the meeting, feeling sorry for myself and depressed and having moved over for 30 days and seeing telling me it will be better, be grateful for what you have, and keep coming back. People who were new in the fellowship would come over to my house and fall still me. They kept me coming back. They told me that they loved me. I was depressed for 2 months like that and during that time 2 more meetings started. I was making 3 meetings a week and I started learning the steps. I was getting involved in our area service and started being grateful for everything I had. I was so grateful to be alive and I believe that that is because of DNA. Fellowship, it was time for me to get up off my butt and start doing something for others. I started doing public information work in my area and started accepting God over me. I attended a lot of meetings and spoke very often, trying to carry the message of recovery through NA. I tried giving away what I had to other people, especially the newcomers. I prayed very often and that hollow feeling of being different didn't apply anymore. I attended conventions and conferences. At one of these, I had a spiritual awakening. I saw a tiny glimpse of God over me, and I prayed for the courage to carry. Free service. I can make a hospice for many addicts who seek recovery to find in an NA. I finally asked someone if he would sponsor me and I started to even come out with the words that he said, okay. We moved away from each other 2 months later and I had to ask someone else, and I did. It's been working out really good. He got me to do something else and think for myself. The aimless wandering I had done all my life has finally subsided. I learned to enjoy living a day at a time. I tried to enjoy my struggle with the steps. I knew that when I got to the end of the road, I would be happy. Today I learned to experience the road I'm walking on, not the road itself, but seeing where I want to be. I'm happy here I am today and feel I'm making progress in life. Today, I work with steps with the guidance of my sponsor and I attend 3 or 4 meetings every week. I attend meetings to share my experience, strength, and hope. Other members learn from me in this way and I learn from them when they share. It is important for me to always remain teachable. I pray every day and thank God for each day, the 12 steps, and this fellowship of Narcotics Anonymous. My gratitude speaks 205. My gratitude speaks. I was born in a
escape class clown. In 1972,
I could really relate, and I saw how
overwhelming, I knew I could not fight it. Desperately, I glanced around the room. These people could stay clean. I could not. They were not like me. I was going to get loaded. No, I thought. No, God, help me. God, restore me to sanity, I cried in my mind. When I said that I tingled and the compulsion left, I was overwhelmed. I tried it again. It worked. It worked. Now, I really could stay clean. Even me. I did everything you told me to do. I was as though you were only denying to me. I made 90 meetings in 90 days. I got a sponsor and I called him twice a day and we talked for hours. At the NA meetings I felt an awareness between us addicts. I felt NA was really solid and it was the rock on which I would surrender my life. I did something very important. I stuck with the people who were serious about staying clean. We were into service work, emptying ashtrays, setting up and cleaning up meeting halls. We would get there early and leave late, then I would call my sponsor at midnight and we would talk until 2 in the morning. I would take hot baths at night and pray and write down my concept of God until 4 a.m. Then I would get to sleep. My parents supported me and I tried to show my gratitude and love for them. They paid $50,000 a year for hospital. Today new NA work. It is the only thing that ever worked, but I had to be beaten to the very end. I did as much as I could do. If I had used any more, I know I would be dead. I feel my disease is progressive. Today if I used it would be even worse than when I stopped. It has subtle ways of trying to get me to use, like 208 Narcotics Anonymous. Bluster and lust, anger and pride, but I always remember what my last one did for me, and say, no thanks, not today. Going to any lengths to stay clean is a big part of the NA program, in my opinion. I would work the steps or tunnel to China to stay off drugs. I feel I have found in NA the way to daylight and freedom. If I ever use again, I would die and lose everything. So, I just don't use today. I do not remember the good times using, that is not a good first step. I remember the mental hospital, the suicidal thoughts, and the times when I was hurting very badly. I do not want that. So, I came to believe in a loving God who can restore me to sanity. I pray for God to reveal himself to me in ways that I can understand. I pray, God, genuine faith. Then I turn my will and life over to the care of God. I know that my way did not work, so I have to surrender to God's will for me, which I do not understand, but which turns out better than anything I have planned. I pray to the same God to write my inventory for me. In this way, I sat at a desk for 2 or 3 hours and did write down some defects of character and some assets. I began to see my inner nature. I did not share my inventory with another human being for a week or so. During that week I was frustrated and hurt. I would go back and work on my fourth step and get nowhere. Then I learned a very important thing, to go back and read the inventory. When I did that, I saw it was time for a fifth step. Next was getting ready to have the defects removed. Of course, I had a good sponsor take me through these steps and I learned to be gentle to myself and be my own friend. When I became my own friend, God added a woman to my life. That has been a learning and growing experience. The relationship forced me to work the steps and call my sponsor. I learned I was still insecure and had to make amends and demonstrate my goodwill. By working the 11th step, I feel protected from turbulent emotions. I can stay more calm and rational in busy days or hard times, like when my girlfriend is playing games. In relationships, I have learned that I have to be my own best friend and work on myself. Then I have something that the woman wants. I think women get beautiful gifts and are great teachers. Nothing has been so rewarding as working with other addicts. No matter what is happening in my life, I know I can get out of my self-centered trip by simply becoming interested in the welfare and recovery of a newcomer or an old-timer in pain. My story, by the grace of God, has a happy ending, thanks to NA. I would like to thank them in my anonymous. Mama worked all my life. The black maids that raised us kept the radio on the rock and roll stations all the time, and they kept the atmosphere pretty loose around the house during the day. I like the way they seem to live and think much better than the lifestyle my parents were trying to teach me. What I seem to want most in life was attention. I usually got it. I was bright, pretty and wild, with a tactile spirit. I decided early on that I would grow up to be either a singer, a writer or an artist. By the time I was 14, I had chosen singing as a career. In the late 60s, there was very little of a subculture trickling into our community, compared to some of the larger cities. But, eventually, through the mass media, a little hippie movement was starting to blossom in our city. I had seen people like that in movies and I really thought they were neat. The men all looked like rock stars and I wanted what they had. When my older brother discovered pot, I was close on his heels. He found out where all the flower children hung out and joined them. To his embarrassment, so did I. He was witty and handsome, so older kids in the street seemed like him right from the start. I didn't feel like I had anything to offer these wonderful people, so I donated my body to the cause. I donated it to any guy that looked the way I wanted him to look, especially if there were drugs available. I had my first case of illicit drugs at 14, when I was sent out of town for an illegal abortion, and the doctor gave me morphine. I liked most of the effects. I had been experimenting with alcohol since early childhood and was quickly becoming a partier. Anytime anyone suggested a new kick, like cough syrup or booze, I tried it. Once I found the right sources, I began taking all kinds of goodies. I really liked smoke, in all its forms, especially hashish. I had my first hit of acid when I was 15, and I dropped speed in pill form every chance I got. Doubters never really agreed with me, but I took them. Even back then I can remember a real sense of desperation in trying to find drugs when none were around. The drugs I took gave me the first real freedom I had ever known. I depended on them to expand my mind, to relax me, and to mix with my good buddies. When I was 16, our family moved to South America. I was 4 months pregnant again, and I'd been eating acid every other day or so for the first 3 months of the baby's gestation. The premature baby I gave birth to died in less than 5 hours. Its little insides were deformed in it. No excuse for loneliness 211. For a couple of months after that, my parents kept me under lock and key, but they couldn't hold me for long. The pot in Colombia was strong and it drew me like a magnet. After a year we returned to the States and I was enrolled in school. It had been a long time since I had been in school, so I didn't adjust to the discipline well at first. During my first couple of months back I continued to use it to fool around with a lot of guys, but that changed when I came down with hepatitis. School got better for me without the drugs. My mates were brave and I even won medals in superlatives. Unfortunately, I had been working on a correspondence course for my junior year and I never did finish it. I skipped graduation day, in order to avoid the embarrassment of being the only senior to walk away with no diploma. I lied about that fact for years. When my 18th birthday arrived, I tried to get out of the house as soon as possible. I had run away from home once before and the legal aspects of it had brought me back. Now I was free to go, but of course it never occurred to me that I had no idea where I was going. First I hitchhiked out of the state to visit a lover, only to return brokenhearted when his mother threw me out of their house. Then I moved in with my brother's rock band, until they kicked me out too, for playing head games with three of the musicians at once. From then on I missed people in order to have a place to sleep. Believe me, they moved me too. I had never worked in my life, so when it dawned on me that I would be supporting myself, it came as a shock. I had several jobs. The first job I had was cleaning beer in our town's first hippie bar. After that, I went from one thing to another, until I landed a really easy gig mining shop in a health food store. For a while I stayed away from most drugs because I was on a health kick. Unfortunately, I still had my compulsive personality and I grew up like a balloon. I might have looked healthy and serene, but deep down inside I hated myself. It became obvious to me that something was terribly wrong with me. Here I was, clean from drugs, and all I could do with myself was eat like a pig and hole up in my room. Music was the only thing I had going for me. There was a piano player that moved in with me, and we went everywhere together, even to the bathroom. Both both of us had very high ideals about spirituality that we tried out on one another and found to be impossible. Of course, it was the kind of thing that called for organic drugs, like peyote, mushroom, pot and such, so I started using again. 212 Narcotics Anonymous. Right before my 19th birthday, I left town, heading west. I didn't have a dime. I didn't bother to tell my mother and father where I was going. I didn't even give an hour's notice at work. I just left. Once I got out there, I got weird. The street scene reminded me of the one in South America, and I fell into it immediately. The first people that took me in were the Blue type. They were pretty interesting, but I got restless. The next trip I fell in was more down to earth. There was a street gang in the town that rolled the block. One of the members took a liking to me, so I moved in with him. We loved each other as much as either of us was capable of loving anyone, but we sure had funny ways of showing it. We screwed around on each other all the time, and when he wasn't throwing me out or taking me back, I was running out the door with my thumb outstretched. We were lovers for about 6 months before his death. One night when he was out on the strip peddling MDA, the police searched him. Before they could find anything, he ate the entire stash, which was enough to intoxicate 10 people. His mother came to the funeral and she gave me a ring that had been taken off his dead finger. I still wear it. This man's death was the turning point for me. It was the excuse I wanted to just let go of all sense of dignity and just stay loaded and filthy. Before his death, I had been living however and wherever I could. I hadn't really been staying stoned all the time. I tried to be useful and kind to people, and I was even creative at times. But once my lover was gone, I was free to let everything fly. I went on a drunk for about 6 months, traveling around the country. I supported myself by panhandling, and I stayed drunk and stoned on anything I could find, all the time. There was usually a man in my life whose main function was to protect me from the evils of the road. Sometimes, though, the men I chose were the evil. During that time, I changed my outlook and my behavior drastically. In the early years, I was so peaceful that I didn't even eat meat. Now I was violent and hostile. There were several instances of rape, which went unreported to the authorities. A woman hitchhiking is considered easy prey to sexual abuse, and I knew that I had no sympathy from them. I sobered up a time or two and I found myself in jail, and I made several jails all over the country. Rape and arrest were just part of the package of living the way I was living, so I accepted them without question. After almost a year of living on the road, in and out of jail, in and out of scrape, I returned to my hometown, broke, sick, and beaten. Of course, my old friends from high school were still around, so I figured that I had no excuse for loneliness, 113. Taken care of, they didn't respond to me the way I'd anticipated. Frankly, they didn't seem to want to have anything to do with me, so I switched around. Humiliated, I ended up moving in with my family, because they were the only people that would claim me. That's developed some serious emotional illness. It has taken me years of living the NAA to get over that first year with my own program. For one thing, I became an anorexic, suffering from a disease just as devastating as all of my other addictions put together. When I wasn't starving myself, I was compulsively gorging myself and vomiting. I also went into a 3-month depression when I didn't even have enough space to walk outside, because I didn't trust the sidewalk to be there. I lived in constant paranoia and I lost control over my emotions. I cried at the drop of a hat. 214 Narcotics Anonymous. One day I woke up so upset that I just had to have help. I wanted to get my hands on some drug, any drug. The only help I could find in the phone book was a program that helps people with drinking problems. I knew I had a drinking problem when I drank, so I figured they'd let me slide in under the wire. I also knew that if I didn't call someone to keep me from using, I would call someone that would get behind. The day I walked into that clubhouse, shaking and crying, nobody had any reason to believe that I hadn't had any food or any drugs for almost a year. I was a wreck. After all those months of clean time, I was just as jumpy, just as lost, as a person who'd been on a drunk the night before. I read and memorized the literature I was given and I did several inventories.